सर का कम से कम 3 से 4 पेज का बायोडाटा है और इतना वास्ट एक्सपीरियंस है। तो मैं हमारे रीजनल कस्टमर सर्विस हेड श्री मोइन खान सर को बोलूंगा कि प्लीज हमारे जो आज के एक्सपर्ट लेक्चर है एलके जैन सर, उनके बारे में कुछ ब्रीफ दें और हमारे गेस्ट का वेलकम करें। हैंड ओवर टू मोइन खान सर।
Yeah, thanks, Chandrasekhar. Good morning, everybody, and a very, very warm welcome in this webinar online series of technical knowledge sharing programs, which are being conducted, I mean, with a higher intensity in this lockdown period. So, we are trying to make the best use of this lockdown period. We all are in home, so we have enough time to spend for learning. And actually, I read a quote some days before that if in this lockdown period we are not able to, you know, improve our knowledge and skills, so that means that we were never having, you know, the deficiency of time. We were having the deficiency of discipline. So I mean that was a very good quote which I read. कि इस time भी इतने time में अगर हम लोग नहीं कर पा रहे हैं कुछ अपना skills और knowledge के लिए, so that means कि हम लोग सीखना चाहते थे बट हमारे पास टाइम की कभी कमी नहीं थी, इच्छा की कमी थी. तो दैट इज द मैसेज विच वी आर ट्राइंग टू फॉलो, दैट वी आर ट्राइंग टू यू नो ब्रिंग. एंड यू नो टुडे आई एम रियली वेरी वेरी थैंकफुल टू एलके जैन साहब. वी वर डिस्कसिंग लास्ट वीक भी, हमने डिस्कशन किया 2-3 बार हुआ, एंड आई मीन ही टोल्ड मी कि यार आपको क्या किस टॉपिक पे बात करवानी है मुझे बताओ, मैं तो 6 घंटे तक बोल सकता हूँ. तो I mean, he is such a gem of a person, and साथ में he is the renowned consultant not only in Maharashtra, Nagpur, but all over India and across the globe also. So we are very, very, you know, delighted to have him on this forum. And basically, जैसा चंद्रशेखर ने बताया कि सर के बारे में मैं बहुत ज़्यादा क्या बोलूँ, because उनका जो experience है वही अपने आप में काफ़ी है. Right now he is in, currently his age is 73 years, and he is in 1966 he has graduated from the Nagpur Engineering College, and with obviously with a merit position. He is the panel member of lot of, you know, BIS committees, and in almost all the cement and concrete courts, IS courts which have been developed, he is the member of those committees. He is special expertise on the design of and construction of the water retaining structures. So he was, you know, I asked him ki sir ek sawa ghante ka session rahega, to he told ki we can take on this water tanks, very specific on the water tank. Otherwise the overall, you know, construction and design of the water retaining structures is a very vast subject. So we will, in further course of time, we will take some more topics. Sir is having, as I told, a vast experience not only in you know designing as a BIS committee member, but also the teaching experience. He is in academic also. He is having a very good you know presence. Why, he is a vice chairman of Asian Concrete Federation, national president of Indian Concrete Institute. He's past national president. And he is also national past president of Association of Consulting Civil Engineers. He is a member of technical committee of Bureau of Indian Standards, dealing with cement and concrete standards, dealing concrete courts. And I mean, this is a very long woe. And for the engineers, particularly here, for the IS 456, which we generally call as a Bible of you know RCC. So he is also a member of the panel for IS 456 RCC design. So now I'll not spend much time, because he's if I'm going to read everything, so I think 1 hour will be not sufficient for you know discussing about his achievements and about his profile. So I will straight away request Mr. LK Jain to start his session. One request to everybody: we have deliberated, done the muting. We all of you are on the mute, and I will also request that. For the internet, you know, smooth running of the internet on your devices, it will be advisable that you can switch off the video mode, because unnecessary the, you know, this internet will be spent on this. So it might affect your internet speed. The chat option is disabled for now. Almost 40-45 minutes later, this chat option will be open for all to put the questions. And then at the end of the session, we will take one by one all the questions. And in case if any question is not, we are not able to address due to the limitation of time, you can see on your screen, Mr. Jain has given his email ID. So you can write this email ID and you can write whatever your questions or comments or anything you need from Mr. Jain on this mail. So thanks everybody and over to Mr. Jain.
Sir, इसमें मैं एक चीज ऐड करना चाहूंगा. आज के क्वालिटी कंक्रीट कंस्ट्रक्शन फॉर वाटर टैंक्स के लिए डिटेल ड्राफ्ट सर ने सब शेयर किया है. आप उस मेल पे लॉग इन करके गूगल ड्राइव से डाउनलोड कर सकते हो. उसकी लिंक हमें भेजा है. प्रोग्राम के एंड में भी हम आपको लिंक देंगे. प्लस हमारा सबसे एक बेहतरीन ऐप सब इंजीनियर्स के लिए और आर्किटेक्ट के लिए है, जिसका नाम है कॉन्क्रीट क्लब. वो गूगल ड्राइव पे अवेलेबल है. इट इज वेरी गुड ऐप फॉर ऑल इन्फ्लुएंसर. इफ अपना वेबिनार खत्म होने के बाद मैं आप सबसे रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि प्लीज आप उसे डाउनलोड कीजिए, कॉन्क्रीट क्लब ऐप इन गूगल ड्राइव. थैंक यू सर. एंड मैं जैन सर से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि सर प्लीज आप प्रोसीड कीजिए. थैंक यू सर.
वेलकम फ्रेंड्स, यू कैन हियर मी ऑल?
यस सर,
योर ऑडियो.
ओके, नाउ ऑल कॉन्क्रीट स्ट्रक्चर्स रिक्वायर्ड गुड क्वालिटी. वी कांट अफोर्ड एनी ऑफ द कॉन्क्रीट स्ट्रक्चर टू हैव लेस देन व्हाट वी कैन कॉल गुड क्वालिटी, बिकॉज दे आर टू serve the society. But however, we find that water tank is most important because it doesn't tolerate any water retaining structure, doesn't tolerate any deviation in our quality. Hence, though I'm talking of good quality construction, but preference I'm giving of water tanks, because water tank doesn't tolerate. So though it is applicable, what I'm speaking is applicable for all concrete construction. When we want to do a good quality construction, we should work systematically. We have to collect data, prepare design, a design report, and detailed drawings. This total is a documentation which is necessary, which has including foundation condition, design, construction data. And this is necessary for a good understanding between all the engineers, those who are either supervising or constructing, or somebody is specifying. You see, a construction is a teamwork. Furthermore, immediately we find if there are some problems, we have to rectify. In new construction also, and later on we need maintenance, and much later maybe condition assessment. For all these activities, this documentation is required. Now the important consideration, apart from structural design, that is we design for strength, the important consideration is durability. More and more we find our reinforced concrete structures, we are worried about durability rather than strength. There are very less chances that there is something wrong in design and the structure doesn't have enough strength. But what we find is in many a times when you say at most places, most of the structures are done properly, but there are enough of problems which become a headache for engineer, and that relates to durability. Now, when we are looking at durability, we have to look in from the angle of what are the mechanisms or processes which lead to loss of durability. And for each of this process, we have to design. Now, till now, our present, at present, the design is a rather prescriptive design, prescriptive specification, and not become the method of design. Now the maximum, the most important issue is reinforcement corrosion in water retaining structures as well as many other structures in normal buildings also. If you look into the mechanisms, one is leaching of calcium hydroxide. After the hydration of concrete, calcium hydroxide is formed, and this calcium hydroxide is in the concrete in the form of weak crystals. Now, if water is penetrating in and trying to move out, in normal buildings, every year the building becomes wet in rainy season, and this water comes out and dries out whenever it's not raining, and thus we find calcium hydroxide comes out. Now, what comes out leaves behind porosity, and permeability of concrete reduces. If calcium hydroxide is coming out, the pH of the pore solution also reduces. Around the steel, the pH of concrete, if it reduces, the corrosion rate can increase. The steel gets corroded whenever it gets air and water. So water is available in the pores of the concrete, and somehow the concrete is permeable for air also. So air is also available. But normally, if pH is high around the steel, the corrosion rate is very small, such that it may take many years, 30, 40, 50 years to have a sizable corrosion, and that's how we get acceptable structure. If rate of corrosion increases, the problem comes. This rate increases as the pH goes down. So pH can go down by leaching of calcium hydroxide. Now, this in water tanks can happen, because from the wall of water tank, if water is leaking from one place to another, the calcium hydroxide, it can leach out. The other is the chloride ion penetration. When chlorides are there in atmosphere or in water, the chloride can come up to steel surface, means it penetrates through the cover zone, and a certain chloride ion concentration, when it reaches, it breaks the tight film formed by corrosion products, that is iron compound plus cement hydration product together. A tight film is formed over the reinforcement surface. Now this is broken or damaged, and hence the corrosion can start. So rate of corrosion depends upon pH, and if this film is broken, the rate will be higher. In this regard, to have control over these aspects, we find use of supplementary cementitious material. We call SCMs, which are fly ash, GGBS, silica fume, etc. Now their use is of advantage. The calcium hydroxide, which is in excess, it doesn't give us much of the strength, only it is filling in pores. Now that can be fixed by these use of CSMs, that is fly ash, etc. So, but some people had a fear otherwise long back, that if all calcium hydroxide is consumed by fly ash or other SCMs, the alkalinity will reduce. It's not really so. The that reaction of fly ash with calcium hydroxide will continue till alkalinity is there. So some alkalinity is always maintained. It can't be zero. So to that extent, the reaction takes place with pozzolana. Now when this reaction takes place, now this reaction is a delayed reaction. after the hydration of cement. So this is the second action. Now, as the term is tossed by ACC only, double acting cements. So our pozzolanic cement is double acting cement. So in second phase, the reaction takes place. So whatever are the pores, available pores are utilized for the second reaction, and the pore structure is improved, and hence the porosity is reduced. Also, the transition zone, which is very weak, that is transition zone between aggregate and paste, is also improved. This is how the porosity is reduced and permeability is increased. The increase of permeability is more contributed by micro crackings. Young concrete, when is setting and taking strength, hardening it, is subjected to temperature variation. In the core, the temperature is higher, at the surface, temperature is lower, as well as shrinkage takes, as the cement hydration takes place, the shrinkage also takes place. And this causes micro cracking, and we should be reducing this cracking. We should take all the precautions to reduce this cracking. That is, gradient, temperature gradient should be small, as well as the shrinkage we should avoid, or we should reduce or control. So designing for durability requires, in present day knowledge, as the practice is, normal widespread practice is, we choose the concrete, and that is the grade of concrete. So we specify minimum grade of concrete for each mechanism of loss of durability. We have seen few mechanisms. If you see the write-up given to you, which you'll download and will be available, it's about more than a 60-page write-up. In that, those recommendations are given in detail. So grade of concrete, we have to choose. Similarly, water cement ratio, we have to choose limiting. That is maximum water cement ratio. It should not exceed. And for a particular mechanism, we have to provide enough of clear cover. So these three are the recommendations which we are given in IS 456, as well as in IS 3370 for water retaining structure to design. In future, we'll be designing this structure knowing the mechanism of loss of durability, say chloride and penetration, how many years it will take to reach a particular concentration, knowing the permeability of concrete through cover, knowing the thickness of concrete cover, we can design how many years it will take of a given years, how much clear cover will need, or what grade of concrete or permeability will need. This will be a little futuristic, and all academic knowledge is available, but design codes yet are not in this regard. If chloride ion penetration is heavy, or when chloride ions are many more, availability is much more, anti-chloride surface applications are required. Now here, for durability, we were talking that what a keyword is permeability. Permeability is an important word, but still we are not checking permeability, except some large structures are very important, bridges, etc., or some atomic energy structures, some permeability tests are done. There are a number of permeability tests, and one can take one of the most popular is chloride ion penetration test, which can be done. There is an Indian standard also on one of the permeability tests, but that test is very cumbersome. So still we are not specifying the permeability limits, but we are going with the grade of concrete and the water cement ratio limits, etc. There are some tests which can be done on in situ concrete, how much water it can absorb, in a particular time. That is how the tests are done. Some Indian standards are also available. Now, the exposure condition, we should have knowledge. What type of exposure condition? In case of water tank, the water, it is exposed to water. If there is a sewage treatment plant, it is sewage. Sewage is a little chemically more aggressive. So we have to know the exposure condition. A water tank may be in a marine environment or coastal area, or where the industrial area where flumes are coming, because if some exhaust flumes are coming from some chimney, it will have a lot of sulfates in that. So we should know the exposure condition, and accordingly we should classify our exposure condition and take precautions about exposure. As 456 gives you some guideline about sulfate attack, freeze and thaw, and heavy chemicals and so on. Heavy chemical attack. Now, with reference to water tank, water tightness is important. Many people also know it, not only water tank, but in buildings also, the roof may be subjected to water leakage, and then it becomes a havoc for people using it. But there, the water pressure, the pressure by which water is entering into the concrete is very small. But whereas in a water tank, the bottom surface, at the bottom slab or the bottom end of the wall, the water pressure is very high. It may be 3 to 5 meters of that order, and hence water tightness is very important. What for water tightness, what we need in all concrete structures is to avoid macro defects, the large defects, that is segregation, honeycomb, bleeding channels. All these defects we have to avoid. Now, having avoided these macro defects, which doesn't give us the passage of water, the quality of concrete at micro level is important. That is poria, the porosity, permeability of water, and pore configuration, etc., for which something we have been talking a little earlier. We had just talked. And the permeability to large extent is increased by cracking of the concrete. Where crack comes, that becomes a straight channel for water to pass through. So flaws in concrete, movement joints, construction joint, cracks, these influence the leakages. So leakages are because of this. And of this, movement joints, we should give minimum. We can design movement joints in the concrete. Construction joints, we have to give. We cannot pour the whole water tank in one go. There are trains nowadays, bridges, to pour 10 to 15 meter high piers in one go. 1 or 2 meter high beam in one go without cold joint. One go means layer by layer, but without forming cold joints, or what we call construction joints. Now, cracks we cannot avoid. The only thing is, cracks, if it is reinforced concrete will always crack. As normally said, everybody has a cold. Cold is a common cold, we call it. Everybody has. So crack, every concrete cracks. If we don't want cracks in concrete, we have to pre-stress it. But we can, unwanted cracks, large cracks we can avoid, we have to avoid. Fine cracks can be there, but we have to see that the cracks are fine, which do not permit heavy leakage. So leakages are influenced by H by T ratio. H is the head of water, which is thrusting water to permeate through concrete, and T is the thickness of member. In a water tank wall, at the bottom end of the wall, if 5 meter is the head of water and 200 mm is the thickness of concrete, H by T ratio will become 25. So this is how this H by T, as it increases, the chances of leakage increases. The limiting H by T ratio for ordinary workmanship is 20. Average workmanship is 25. So we should be in this margin. Exceptionally good workmanship X, if we have, we can go up to 30. 35 is very difficult, but to keep up with international norms, this category is kept under excellent condition. When things are excellent, we can go up to 35. But normal range is 20 to 25. If we keep H by T ratio within this and we take proper precautions at the construction joint, we can limit the leakages, or we can reduce the water tightness. Water tightness can be good. Now in the modern code, which is now coming as 3370, we have revised, and within a month new published code will be available on printed copy will be available. So water tightness classes we have defined. Class 1, where leakages are small, and normally our structures are in this class 1 type structures, where dam patches are allowed. Which if you see on the external face of a wall of a tank, some dampness will appear and patches will come somewhere, because concrete is good everywhere, most of the places, but wherever there is some problem comes, it leaks. Some water percolates out and the patch comes. So that much of is permitted. Class 2 water tightness is when leakage is so minimum that the appearance of concrete is, it doesn't appear to be wet or dry, and patches doesn't come, and we want. So in some cases, for architect aesthetic reason also, we want no strain on the surface, and this type of class we want. In this type of class, then we have to limit our crack width to a much finer extent. Then class 3 is when no leakage, means no wet patch, is acceptable. In that case, we have to design pre-stressed concrete structure, no tension in concrete. And if leakage is absolutely minimum or absolutely not there, we don't accept it. Impermeable lining has to be given. Now this about, as I was talking, recommendation about little crack width being reduced for class 2, tight class. Now formwork is important. We have been doing formwork for all our reinforced concrete structure, but we have not been controlling the rigidity of the form. The rigidity of form is very important, and slowly it is gaining the importance. In foreign codes also, this has been specified. The normal type of formwork, when we put in normal buildings, and we say, when we find that, when we deposit concrete and when a man stands at that, some deflection takes place, which is sizable. 2 to 3 mm normally permitted. Sometimes it is much more. A good rigid formwork is that formwork should not deflect by more than 1 millimeter. If formwork is deflecting, what happens is along the formwork, the concrete is deflecting, the reinforcement cage is deflecting, and reinforcement bar and concrete are not bound properly. An interface is formed, which is a loose interface. So our bond strength is poor, and that surface itself gives a place for leakage to take place. That means the permeability of concrete along the bars will increase. So in future, whenever we want a good class of work, the rigidity of formwork is important, and formwork should be highly rigid. So we'll find that rigidity will control the formwork rather than strength of the formwork. There are form ties. फॉर्म वर्क फूलना नहीं चाहिए अपने को मालूम है बोलते हैं सो देर आर टाइज गिवन सो व्हेन वी कंस्ट्रक्ट वॉल फॉर्म टाइज आर गिवन बट नॉर्मली दिस फॉर्म टाइज शुड नॉट बी थ्रू दे आर थ्रू लेटर ऑन वी हैव टू फिल विद मॉर्टर एंड दिस विल बी ए पैसेज फॉर परमेबिलिटी ऑफ कॉन्क्रीट हाई परमेबिलिटी ऑफ फ्रॉम दिस मॉर्टर और दिस passage which is filled in by some type of material. So normally we should avoid, if we are doing ties, the ties should be with some flanges. Those are called creep flanges, or they can be broken ties. There are methods. Those ties are in two or three parts. So once the bolting is done, it is total one tie. Now we can remove the cover from the cover portion, both cover portion, the portion which has by screwing action, and in middle portion the tie portion remains with nut. So, but it is not a through tie, and from the end where we have removed the screw, we have to fill in by proper material. Now, surface quality of concrete. Finishing surface as well as the smooth the quality of formwork surface, the formed surface, we should look into, and this also controls the permeability of concrete. If surface is good and smooth, tight, hard surface, the permeability reduces because any penetration is first resisted at the surface and then through the material. While deshuttering the formwork, the temperature we have to keep control over. When deshutter it, if a heavy wall is there and timber formwork we are using, as soon as we deshutter, the walls will have higher temperature, and as soon as we deshutter, we may spray a cold water over it, and this is how a temperature shock is experienced by the concrete. But this should be avoided. A temperature, a sudden cooling of the surface, the finer cracks will form on the surface. So this cooling should be gradual. It may take few hours, 2-3 hours. Then designing the formwork along with it, releasing system. How formwork is going to be released? The sequence we have to watch properly, because this can contribute also, improper sequence can contribute to some cracks coming into the concrete. When we construct tanks with dome bottom or ins type of shape, the formwork is very much complicated, and then with that we have to design that formwork properly, and then we should have a deshuttering sequence properly evolved. Now, embedments. We embed many things in normal concrete structure. If it is building, many things we embed. In water tanks also we have to embed something. Say for example, electrical conduits. If I am doing a sewage treatment plant, some plants will require some electrical motor connection and all that, or that electrical piping will be there, conduits will be there, which have to embed, similar to what we do in buildings. In water tank also, we have lightning arrestor fixed at top, and the conductor will go down. The conductor can go down on the external surface, then maybe it is, somebody may steal it. Copper plate can be stolen. If we embed into concrete, it becomes embedded. So we should be very cautious about the aluminum embedments. If there is anything aluminum reacts with concrete, that is the alkalinity of concrete, and gives out the gas. And this is the aluminum corrosion. It is very fast. It's much faster than the steel. So if there is anything about aluminium, if you are embedding, it must be coated properly so that reaction doesn't take place. Insulated. it should be insulated. So aluminum has to be insulated as electrical conductor and chemically also insulated. So insulation should serve both the purposes. The other conduits are in pipes. Piping, if we are doing the piping, there are two. One is the embedded in concrete, another is just crossing the concrete. So if it is embedded in concrete, we should see that it doesn't occupy more than 4% of the area. If it is more than that, then we have to design it proper. We have to reinforce, design it proper. Then our embedments should not be inducing corrosion. So if it is an iron embedment, it may be corroding. So whatever material we are putting in, we should know how it will react with the alkalinity of concrete and whether corrosion will be allowed. Corrosion will take place, and do we permit that corrosion? Yes, we don't permit any corrosion, so it has to be coated properly. So embedments have some effect on the strength of concrete. Normally it is very small when embedments are small, but if it is large, we have to take care in the design. If piping is there and its cover is small, cover to the piping, it does very much affect the crack propagation. Where we know in buildings, in slabs, when we put electrical conduit, we get a crack along the conduit, and we have to have enough of reinforcement between the concrete cover and that conduit, perpendicular to conduit, a reinforcement to control those cracks. Now, dissimilar metals, even steel of two different types, we have to insulate from each another, because dissimilar metal forms the electrical, if not electrically isolated, it forms a galvanic action, and corrosion can be much faster. Now these were the precautions which we have to take as special, but when we come to the site, concrete production and concrete pouring, we'll look into most of this. Both precautions or the precautions we have to take are common, as we know it already. The production should be under a system of quality control, and production control data should be recorded. Normally there is method in all RMCs, a system is there, and they are controlling, they are recording all the data, so that whenever we need some data later on to be seen, it can be retrieved. Now mixing should be uniform, as everybody knows, but we don't know that the mixers we are using has different efficiency of mixing. At one end, we have been using on many sides tilting drum mixer, which even after mixing for 2 to 3 minutes, even 3 minutes, doesn't give a uniform concrete. If whatever discharge we get from a tilting drum mixture, initially we get aggregate, and at the end of the discharge of from the drum, we get mortar portion. So mixing is not good, and further hand mixing is allowed. We should choose a mixer which gives us proper mixing. At the other end, the modern mixers which are available in the batch mixing plants gives mixing, a very good mixing, within 30 seconds. So we should have a highly efficient mixer to mix the concrete, a good efficient mixer, I'll call it. But if you are adding fly ash or any pozzolanic material at site, there are two ways to add these materials. Pozzolanic materials are added with cement, and supplier, that is cement manufacturer, gives you those cements. We call blended cement, that is Portland pozzolana cement, Portland fly ash cement, and a new type of cement where fly ash and GGBS both are there, we call it composite cement. Now, these cements are, so mixing of cement is done in a factory, which is a good mixing. So we need a good mixing of pozzolana and cement properly. So we don't use a primary mixer to mix this first and then put all this with aggregate in concrete mixer. So our mixing efficiency of concrete mixer should be very high, something similar to what we do in batch mixing plant if we are using fly ash or GGBS at site. So if site mixer, highly efficient mixer is not available, please use pozzolanic cement and see that the dispersion of all material is uniform, even after mixing, after transport. And when we come to pouring concrete, see that the mix is uniform and proper, everything is properly dispersed. There is a tendency of tempering this mix. When the concrete was done at the site, people used to put little more water in the drum. If it is not done at site, after the transit mixer arrives at site, somebody tries to put a little water, or if people are little better knowledgeable, better in knowledge, they try to add plasticizer. Now, anything, water or plasticizer, if added at site, is tempering of concrete. Now, this can be permitted only if there is a provision kept while mix proportioning, we call it mix designing, to do this. Second dosing of water or plasticizer, normally water is never permitted. Second dosing of plasticizer at site, if allowed in mix proportioning originally, that second dosing can be provisional. If needed, second dosing can be done, but this should be done at the time of proportioning concrete, that is mix designing it, verifying the mix. If it is done at that time, this tempering, this plasticizer adding can be done. The normal type of precautions which most of the people know but mostly not observed is storage of materials, that is aggregate, sand, and we don't avoid the dust from it, clay and dust, so that all precautions should be taken. The tolerance in weighing should be taken, and the aggregate piles, if doesn't have uniformity in size variation and tolerance in weighing is not done, the final mix design, the grading will go on changing and we'll never get a proper strength or permeability. So if good quality concrete is needed, it is necessary that the tolerance in weighing, that is the grading of aggregate, should be in very narrow margins and grading should not change. A normal specification is aggregate, cement, water, etc. We weigh within plus minus 3% accuracy. Most of the time, water we may not weigh, we can add by volume, but all other materials are weighed. Chemical admixture within plus minus 5% accuracy, we should do it. Conveying of concrete from mixer to the site, that is placement, we take the concrete, there should be no material loss. When we say material loss, means even moisture loss, we should not take place moisture or the mortar portion of it, paste portion of it should not come out. Then we pour the concrete, so pouring should be done at proper place, and from if we are placed at one position and to shift it to next position, we should not use it by we should not use vibrator to do it, that use a segregation. Now, while doing this placement of concrete, and of course with it we have to vibrate it, we should see that we don't create the construction joints. That means cold joint. Somewhere the concrete has set and the next concrete is coming after concrete has set. So this interface is formed. So we have to take precautions against formation of cold joint such interface. As far as possible, for all good quality concrete, we should keep temperature of concrete within 30 degrees of centigrade. When it is not possible in dead summer in position like Nagpur, where most of the Vidarbha, the temperatures are reaching, will reach about 45 degrees. So 30 degrees will be very difficult to achieve, even if all the water we replace by ice flakes. In those cases, we should resort to night concrete, concreting to be done in night, and so on. So we should keep temperature as far as possible smaller. If temperature is higher, the rate of cement hydration will be very high, and with that, the rate of heat of evolution will be high, and hence, rate of heating. In the concrete, the temperature gradient will increase and cracking will be more. For important concrete, we should not allow the core temperature to be raised above 70 degrees. This is an important consideration. Come, not all type of concrete, but some type of concrete, the internal changes take place while concrete is hardening. If the temperature is crossing 70 degrees, certain unwanted type of materials are formed and cracking takes place. So high temperature inside the concrete. So we have a range of about 40 degrees to be increased. But this 70 degrees is, if you start with the concrete having 40 degrees temperature, it is not 80 degrees will be permitted. This 70 is the limit. So we should better start lower temperature, and we should not in any case cross 70 degrees. If thick concretes are there, this may cross. We have already said earlier, avoid macro cracks, bleeding channels. For all good concrete has to be non-bleeding concrete. We should not have a concrete with bleeds. If you find a concrete can bleed, it is better to reduce the water, your grade will improve and concrete will become non-bleed. So better to go for higher grade rather than allow bleeding. If it bleeds, total paste content you can reduce. That is aggregate to paste ratio can increase. That is overall cement can reduce. So either cement can reduce or the strength can go up. But we should have such a concrete which doesn't bleed. Bleed channels are the channels which give you a lot of permeability. These channels or cracks increase the permeability more than 10 to 50 times. So we should avoid that. Segregation and honeycomb plagues havoc. You see, 1,000 times it can increase the permeability. We should all avoid it. Then at site, regular sampling and testing of concrete is required. The concrete should be kept saturated. We'll just see that. Our curing is done in three phases, and the major part of curing, as per our normal course, we say 14 days, but in water retaining structure, because shrinkage cracking is more important. So one stage is with till 75 to 50, 80% strength is obtained. In many cases, you will get this strength within 14 days. And so curing should continue up to this time. There will be two or three criteria for up to what time curing should continue. After curing time is over, the concrete should not be allowed to dry till the tank is filled, because in water tank, this shrinkage is very important, which gives a lot of cracks. Now, in construction, what we need is adequate planning. If you plan each step in detail in advance, we can keep up the quality. At 11th hour, if you say, oh, now this is to be done. See, for example, the vibrator is there. Yes, we have vibrator. Anybody taken a trial? No. Trial, sab working order. One has to see that vibrator is in working order and there is a petrol in it and check before you start any concrete and so on. So adequate planning and checking controls your the concrete operation. Now, the PCC concrete, especially for groundwater tank, we have a PCC concrete over which we lay our concrete, which is watertight concrete. So this PCC should not be porous and it should have finishability. That top surface, we should be able to finish smooth and in level and line. For that, we require enough of fines in that PCC. So we may say strength-wise M10 PCC is good enough, but finishability and smoothness, you'll get in normally M15 grade concrete. Or if you want, you can get an M10 grade concrete with enough fines. Maybe strength can be low, but we should have little more fines. So normal type of PCC are not workable, not proper, and we should have a proper design done for PCC where the grading of aggregate is little more on finer side. Sorry. Construction joints. In water retaining structures, most of the water retaining, our tanks are circular tanks we prefer. So when horizontal construction joints come, these horizontal construction joint in the wall are subjected to some nominal compression. They are hardly in tension except the bottom end of the wall of the tank. There the bending and tension comes, but otherwise they are in compression. So we prefer more of horizontal joint rather than vertical joint. So vertical joints are more demanding as far as the quality of construction is concerned. And these horizontal and vertical joints, we have to grout after all. Ties, I have talked to you earlier also that those should be collar ties and we have to fill those gaps, whatever is formed after removing the ties by tight filling material in these patches, which should have some non-shrink additive also in that. We have precautions for hot and cold weather concrete. In this part of India, normally cold weather concrete is not applicable. In northern India, that's applicable. Hot weather concrete, all precautions we have to take. There is a ice code on that. So we have to not only check the temperature of concrete, but we have to take precautions to avoid the drying of concrete, that is evaporation from the concrete, and heavy winds, heavy wind also we have to shield and so on. Second, we already told avoid formation of cold joints. So in placement, you have to do sequencing such that cold joints are minimum. And whenever cold joints are, we call it construction joints, are allowed, that joint should be at a place where it is agreed upon with the designer and it is specified in drawing. There only we should take up those cold joint. In concrete placement, one important issue is kicker. In buildings, normally people are using kickers. When we start a column lift after doing slab, a small lift of column is poured, which can be 15 centimeter to 25 centimeter height, say maybe 10 centimeter sometime also, 10 to 25 as people may think of, usually 15, 20 is all right. Now, they call it kicker or starter. So that starter is poured once, so that facilitates the putting of formwork for the column further. Now, but this starter or kicker is put at the cost of increasing one construction sequence and adding one more joint. In this kicker or starter, the concrete amount is very small, the amount of concrete. And it so happens many a times that this concrete is left to some workers at site. So for column or maybe for wall, in water tank construction, we may have a wall for a kicker for a wall. So this small concrete is done by those people, and the quality of concrete is very poor. And we are adding one more cold joint. So this is a problem. So we should avoid kicker, and we should take all the precautions that the formwork for wall or column is non-leaking at joint at bottom and is properly fixed such that the bottom doesn't move. So the advantages for which kicker is put, those we can count and take care when we do not provide kicker, but formwork for the bottom of wall is fixed properly and it is non-leaking. I remind you that curing is done in three phases. The first phase is when we just after pouring concrete, we are finishing concrete surface. If it is a slab, we are finishing it and covering that slab by some temporary means till the water ponding is done or some other method like spraying the curing compound is done. So for 1 or 2 hours after pouring concrete, this 1 or 2 hours or sometimes 3 or 4 hours, up to 3-4 hours also, nothing is done. Now this is the time when plastic shrinkage cracks takes place, and all that is to be avoided by taking some action such that the plastic shrinkage cracks doesn't take place and concrete evaporation of water doesn't take place. So misting of concrete or covering immediately by polythene sheet or something like that can be done. The cutting and bending of reinforcement is important, and importance is little more in water tank. For properly doing bending and tying reinforcement, schedule of bending, the bar bending schedule we call it, should be prepared. Bar should be clean. Even yesterday somebody was asking a question. The normally bars which we get for reinforcement at site has some corrosion already on it. Till that corrosion is dusty corrosion only, dust means some type of powder is there, we can tolerate it, it's okay. No scale or rust means rust layer or scale should not be there, it must remove. Or if scales of any other material is there, we should remove it. But simple dustiness is there, that means if you touch by hand and you get a yellow or brown powder in your hand, that can do. It is better to remove if you feel that the powder is more, you remove it by some type of rubbing by some jute cloth or any other material. Oil and mud, if it is in contact, that must be clean. Now, many a times our bars are bent already, or curved bars, large diameter bars, maybe about 20 and above, we get which are curved at center, and that is to be straightened. When it is straightened, we should, and that portion we should carry out a rebend test, means a portion which is straightened, bent again and straightened like that. We should see that there are no fine cracks on the surface of the bar. You can use an ordinary magnifying glass of most ordinary, which many people have in their offices. That type can be used to see that there are no cracks in the bar. So tests, thus, this type of test should be done. If fine cracks are there, it shows that that type of bar is not permitted. When it is bent and rebent, the ductility of bar will reduce, the strength will reduce. Those type are not permitted. Now we are using binding wires, and we just bind, and the end projection of those binding wires are left out as it is projecting towards cover concrete. In water retaining structure, it should not happen like that. And so is all the case in all type of construction. These projections of binding wire should be bent inside, inwards, not in the cover region. Cover is the concrete. We want concrete only and nothing else. And because binding wire is a steel wire, and that is subject to corrosion, so there the cover is reduced. In cover, no other corrodable item you should put. Now, while cutting, bending, placing the bar, we have to see that aluminium is isolated from concrete. So aluminium is to be isolated. The isolation is both electrical and the chemical. Binding wires also, if you are using some different type, nowadays coated binding wires are also available. So coated, if it is electrically coated, it is all right, you can use it. But dissimilar metal, it should not be. If somebody is using the galvanized wire, galvanized reinforcement, then wire should also be galvanized. If you are using stainless steel, then wire should be coated wire, which is having epoxy coating and so on. So we have to avoid dissimilar metals or avoid galvanic action. Laps. Now laps, when we normally say that lap should not be parallel or simultaneous, we should stagger the lap. Staggering the lap means center between lap is more than 1.3 times the lap length. Normally, not more than 25% bar should be lapped at one place. If more bars are lapped at same place, the crack widths can be higher. Now, reinforcement cage as we built should be rigid enough. When we stand on that reinforcement cage, can be of the cage of the wall or cage of a beam and so on. If we stand and do some work, the cage should not move. If it is moving, we should have enough of bracing or enough of diagonal type of bar in addition place, which is not required as a reinforcement, but to limit the movement of the cage. If cage is moving, I told you, the bar will be moving while we are placing the concrete, while we are vibrating the concrete. If bar is moving, the bond of the bar and the concrete will be poor, and the percolation also, that is along that percolation, will be more, and our durability will be not as much as we want. So cage should be rigid. Now this part is little more common with detailing is more common with the design, but during construction also, many times in design, people don't give details at the junction or details of the reinforcement. Some schedules are given only. So this becomes important at site to be known. So reinforcement detailing is very important. The hooks, the bar is bent and hooks are provided. Beyond the curved portion, there has to be some straight portion of the hook.
Yes, sir.
And this length is important. Yes. Yes, anything you want to say? This straight portion is very important. And in normal building construction, this bar bending is left to the bar binder and the bar bender. And he makes a small, he places a very small hook. Normally engineers feel that to check for the hook is not my job, it is a bar binder's job, this is not true. And this, say, if the hook is for ring, the ring will not function properly for taking shear strength if the straight portion is not proper. When the junctions of the members are there, say this is the closing junction, the moment is such that the tension is outside and compression inside, the two members, it can be two members wall, it can be two beams, it can be two, some two members, closing type of junction and opening type of junction. So all type of junction, it can be T junction, X junctions and so on. In the write-up being given to you, you'll find all details. Now I'll deal with only opening junction. And this type of junction is common in water tanks only. It's not common in buildings. Opening junction means tension at on inside face of the corner and main tension bar is on this side. There is some nominal bars will be on the other face of the member. So it can be wall to wall junction. The two wall beating at right angles to each other, or wall to slab junction. Slab may be at bottom and wall at from the above the junction and so on. So these type of junctions are important, and in many places people are doing mistake. Now in this opening type of junction, the main, if you see along the diagonal, if you see a plane along the beam, if you take a section along the beam, the maximum compression will occur at the extreme fiber. So it is a rectangular diagram. It is a linear variation. But along the diagonal, it is never a linear variation. It is a parabolic variation. And at the corner, my compressive stress is zero. So my lever arm is very small. This is one. Second, at along another diagonal, we'll find tension is produced. It is very easily, it can be calculated as we've seen in the next figure. This tension is, if not taken care of, this makes the joint to act as hinge joint and not a rigid joint. So the moment which is applied, if it's not resisted, it will become a hinge joint. We'll see in the next figure. We apply this compression, we apply tension here. So this compression from here, resultant compression, resultant force in this direction, like that, the tension being applied here on the reinforcement and resultant tension is here. And these two forces make, produce a crack at the center, and even the stress can be calculated. So this tension is, this crack is very important, and we have to contain this crack, and hence a detailing is there. So if it is a wall and slab where normally we don't provide stirrups, what we can do is the reinforcement of one of the members, we can continue in the hairpin fashion and bring it back. This should come out by amount equal to effective depth by half the effective depth. Similarly for other members, this bar should bend and continue in the same. Now this is the primary type of detailing in which this crack is contained in almost a hoop. But by containing the crack in the hoop, again, we don't get 100% efficiency. Efficiency of joint is something like 70 to 80%, 70 to 75%, and crack widths are much higher than what we normally expect, and hence a fillet bar is also required. If we provide fillet bar, we are able to control these cracks properly and also provide enough of strength. Now this is showing same detail which I explained you. I'm sorry, I've gone reverse. Now same detailing shown in multicolor. Is it seen properly? Same detailing. Now, many a times people do this type of detailing. That means the bar is bent and they feel from the point, these two are member and this is joint, junction. This junction is treated like God, that God will do everything. So put the bar in the junction equal to anchor length and a junction will take care of it. But junction is not God. Junction is something we have to design. And junction is not absolutely rigid unless we make it rigid. And this is not enough. This detail, if we do it, the efficiency of this detail, moment wise, is only 35%. That is almost at 1/3 of the moment, design moment, this will give way, and beyond that, it will act as a hinge. A huge crack will form. So we should not permit it like this. Now, in joint, we have joints in the water retaining structures are there, and construction joint is one type, and movement joints are also designed many times. I already said that in most of the water tanks, unless they are very big, we avoid designing movement joints. There should not be given any joint. If joints are given, it should be designed, detailed, and properly sealed. So these joints are expansion joint, full contraction joint, partial contraction joint, induced contraction joint, and sliding joints, and so on and so forth. This list is endless. Many more types of joint can be there. The construction joint is where one concreting phase has stopped. There are two phases of concrete. One phase has stopped and second phase will start after a gap of time. And this gap is important. Behavior of this cold joint, we also call it cold joint, depends upon this gap, time lag. The time lag between the two phases should not be more than 80% of the initial setting time of concrete. If initial setting time of concrete is, there is already an IS code on testing initial setting time of concrete. It is something similar to what we test on a very small specimen in laboratory, initial setting time of cement. On a cement paste, you take a needle penetration. Similar one test is done. It can be done at site, but you should have on a cube is the sample taken and a needle is little bigger needle. You penetrate inside and see. So this test is done and you find initial setting time. So initial setting time is normally, nowadays good quality cement is available, is more than an hour. As per our quotes, I think it is about minimum is 50 minutes, but it's much more than that. And normally more than an hour is available. Many times up to 1.5 hour it is available. That is 70, 80 minutes to about 100 minutes it can be available. 80% of that. So we have enough time. So normal precaution is that within about 45 minutes, we should place the concrete. 40 to 45 minutes, we should place the concrete on something we had left earlier. So earlier placement we had left, on which second placement we have to do, we should do within that time. If it is less the time, if that time gap is smaller, if we can do it in 30 minutes, it is very well. If we can do it in 15 minutes, it's much more better. But it should never be more than this time limit. If it is more than this time limit, we call it a cold joint. Then cold joint has no upper limit. In building, somebody stops the work today and resumes the work afterward, maybe second phase of construction of the work after a few months also. So there you have to take a lot of precautions. Now, at the plane of joint, no rebar, no reinforcement should be there. Now, this joint, construction joint, is the interface. This interface is always weak. The permeability to this interface is very high. So if you place any bar such that bar lies in the plane, there are two things. Bar crossing the interface is all right. If it is crossing the interface, after the concrete is done, the interface may be very thin. If it is a crack form, say 0.1 mm, 0.2 mm, so that's the only portion in which bar and that will come in contact. If the crack width is less than 0.2 mm, the bar normally does not corrode in 0.2 mm crack width. So construction joint also, if it is less than 0.2 mm width, it will not have a corrosion problem. But hold the bar lies in that plane, it will have problem, it will corrode and it will open up construction joint. The construction interface should be rough. What you have to do is the old concrete which is left out, you have to do roughening. If it is the old concrete is few days or few months old, you have to do roughening by some type of equipment. It can be chiseling also. If it is young concrete which is few hours old, you can do it by wire brush or by spraying the water jet. By water jet also you can make it rough. So roughening can be done such that the surface roughness, if we see the average you can touch and feel it, but technically to understand it, the roughness should be of the order of 3 to 5 mm. Now you cannot do a roughness more than 5 mm with 20 mm aggregate. If maximum aggregate size somewhere you are using it only is 12 mm, then you cannot do your roughness by more than 3 mm. So 3 to 5 mm roughness is good enough. Normally we are using 20 mm aggregate concrete. So between 3 to 5 is good enough. At construction joint, what happens is shear capacity of the joint in direct shear reduces. And if it is a few hours joint, 2-3 hours joint, the reduction is about 15-20%. If it is a 4-5 hours joint, maybe up to 30%. So a rough joint does the job if shear is not high. If shear is high, we have to provide shear key, which will be specified by a designer. So wherever we leave construction joint, that should be with concurrence of designer and check of designer whether shear key is required or not. Providing a shear key is a complicated matter. So should ordinarily be not done unless required. So roughening we do, which exposes larger aggregate, and shear key we have to provide only if specified in our drawings or specified by designer. If more shear is required, dowels can be designed. If it is a larger member, means dowels are done is normally in up to slabs, maybe 150 mm thick, up to 150 mm thick slabs and walls. If there are more thick members, we can provide shear reinforcement if needed, but as given by designer. And all construction joints should be grouted. Now, this grouting depends upon H by T ratio. We have already discussed about H by T ratio. If H by T ratio is 20, maybe one cycle of grouting is mostly enough for normal type of all junctions. I said one junction, which is bottom of the wall, where bending moment along with tension and shear is also there. There, grouting in two or three cycles are required. If H by T ratio is high, that is 25-30, then grouting is to be done in two or three cycles. Those who do grouting, they know it. Grouting, if there is a problem of grouting has to be done in cycle. If you do one cycle of grouting and achieve some pressure, then fresh places we have to put our nosing and do grouting to a higher pressure. So pressure in one go, you cannot increase the pressure of grouting. So a number of cycles you have to increase it, and normally three cycles are good enough in most of the cases. If concrete is very, very bad, if done very bad, then maybe more cycles may be required. Now adding water bar. If H by T ratio is within the limits as spoken and grouting cycles as needed may be done, the water bar may not be required. If we provide water bar is to avoid leakage through the joint. But what happens is the workmanship what we have to do, providing water bar is very difficult. If somebody can do a good work in spite of providing water bar, I'm sure he can do a good work without water bar. If it's without water bar, the joint is leaky, can grout it. But with water bar, if honeycomb comes or poor concrete comes somewhere near water bar, you'll not be able to notice because leakage will not be there, and one may accept a bad concrete. That is the bad about the use of water bar. However, if H by T ratio is very high, as I said, 30-35, above that, water bar is required. So in some cases, water bar will be required. So option is there, use higher thickness of wall. If I have got 99 meter of water head, I can provide a 45 centimeter wall so that my H by T ratio is not much. If we provide water bar, thickness required of concrete is required much more. I cannot provide a water bar and do a good work if my thickness of wall is only 200 mm. It's not possible. So if water bar I'm providing, minimum thickness required is 30 with difficult, and that too with lot of difficulty workmanship, to achieve workmanship. So maybe a 35. And if water bar and shear key both are required, then it is almost 40-45 is the minimum thickness you have to provide. So this is about the many of the precautions you can take to do a good concrete work. Much more things are given in my write-up, which is I have made available to you, which you can see it here. You can write up, and I think ACC is also taking effort to send you this link. Link is here. You can see the link. This link, with this link, you can download from the whole write-up and keep with you. It's a more than 64 pages write-up. And to do a good quality work, I congratulate you that you joined this and you have interest in that. Go through this write-up and be a good engineer to deliver something good to our society. Thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, friends, also.
We'll take some questions, sir.
Yeah.
There is a question. Just a minute, sir. It's on the screen.
Yeah.
Just. What is the H by T, height thickness ratio?
Yes, I had said that, but again, I'll repeat it. H is the head of water, which is acting on concrete at the point where we are considering it. Say maybe a construction joint or a crack. So H is the head of water. Take in case of water tank, if I have a wall, water tank, my maximum depth is 5 meter. At the bottom of wall, there will be a one joint. At that joint, my head of water will be 5 meters. If 5 meter is the depth of water.
Ah, sir.
T is the thickness of wall. The thickness of wall can be, if suppose 200 mm, so H by 2 T ratio will be 5000, means 5000 mm head, 200 mm is the T. So this ratio comes to 25. Is it clear now? H by T ratio is the hydraulic gradient, you can call it. It is the hydraulic gradient under which water is seeping. Water is seeping through concrete, and hydraulic gradient, as the hydraulic gradient will be more, the leakage will be more. So hydraulic gradient acting on that joint or a crack is H by T. If I have a joint at the middle depth of wall, okay, maybe at 2.5 meter depth, I have a joint. So on that joint, my, is it, you are able to hear?
Yeah, yeah, we are able to hear, sir.
Yeah. So at two and a half meter depth, if there is a joint or a crack at that joint, my H by T ratio will be 2500 divided by 200, which is the thickness of that wall. So H by T ratio is the hydraulic gradient which is applicable for the flow of the water.
Yeah.
Seeping of the water under hydraulic gradient. So that gradient is represented by H by T. Yes, please. Anna. Any other question?
Yeah, actually there are a lot of questions, sir. Yeah. And we will take some. We will take 4 or 5 questions, sir.
Yes.
And the remaining, I will request all to, you already have the email ID of Mr. Jain, so you can get in touch with him. Plus, he has already shared that 60 pages write-up with us. We will arrange it to send, to share with everybody.
Yeah.
On this, who is present in the seminar. So, sir, there are 3-4 questions we will take for the sake of time. Like, yeah. Should we use Mr. Asif Jamadar, he's our one of the engineers from Miraj.
Yeah.
So he want to know that precautions to be taken to avoid cold joints. What are the precautions to be taken to avoid cold joints?
The cold joint we have been talking, the time lag between the two phases. This is what we have to plan. See, for occurrence of this cold joint. If a cold joint has occurred, there are two ways of thinking. If a joint has occurred, what we should do is something like repairs. And in a new construction, the joint can be given only where it is specified by the designer. Till then, we have to do a continuous concrete. Now, perchance, if the joint has occurred because of failure of some of the, suppose the concrete delivery has not come, or maybe some other type of failure, or if you're pouring a slab or something and all of a sudden some accident takes place and you have to stop pouring, the next pour you take after a few hours or maybe on next day, the all loose material from the joint has to be removed. Now all these precautions to be taken are given in my detailed write-up. I think there are 4 pages devoted to construction joint. So if construction joint comes, we have to remove all the loose material from a joint. If the concrete is already hardened, we cannot compact it. And then we have to put a binding material. If shear strength requirement at that shear demand is not high, we can put a rough joint and we restart the concrete fresh. If shear demand is high, we have to put a binding material. If it is after a few months or say maybe 14, 15 days or 28 days, we have to presume that no binding will be done between old and new concrete. We have to have a binder being applied. So you talk to your chemicals, the construction chemical, concrete chemicals, those who supply. So they will supply you some type of binder. It is to be applied. There are different types available and you have to apply a first coat of it and then a second coat of it. And then in next place, you have to put a little mortar in which also some type of polymer will be there. And later on, you have to resume your concreting. There are other type of materials also available which you can just brush it on the old concrete and resume your concreting work and so on. So,
yeah, there is one more
precautions to be taken and all details. This construction joint, maybe more than 4 pages are there in that write-up. Yeah, please.
Okay, sir. So I'll request everybody to go through it. And the other questions are, again, they are related to temperature controlled concrete. shall be used during summer? I mean, there is a question, should we use? Obviously, we should try to use. The temperature controlled concrete should be used during summer. I mean, this is the question. So, right. I think you've already discussed that there is a limit in the, especially in the high heat area like Nagpur.
Yeah.
I mean, there is a limit of controlling the concrete, isn't it?
For all good concrete, you see, whether we talk of high strength concrete, high performance concrete, concrete for water tanks, concrete for pavement, which are normally M45, 50 grade, we require a temperature control over concrete. Or concrete for large foundation pores. Whenever we have large pores, where thickness is more than 45 centimeters, the concrete temperature control is required. And in all these construction, the 30 degrees is a limit given. So this is followed. This 30 degrees limit is more or less a limit in all countries. So we should not have concrete more than 30 degrees temperature. Now in hot summer days, as I already told you, it will be very difficult to control this concrete temperature. Now for controlling the temperature of concrete at the time of pouring, if you have a RMC available between mixing, means from the RMC plant to the site, the temperature increase for the concrete which is taken less than a concrete which is less than 30 degrees in summer, 4 to 8 or 9 degrees can be added. The temperature increases of this order. If the distance is also minimum, unless we have a concrete of 26 degrees at the time of pouring, it will be 30 degrees. To produce a 26 degrees temperature concrete is very difficult in the atmospheric temperature of 45. So to reduce temperature, the normal precaution is we have to cool all the aggregates. The first is to replace water by ice, depending upon how much temperature you want to reduce. If you replace all the water being added by ice flake, ice you cannot use in form of those cubes, but in flakes only, because it should dissolve in the mixer. So if you put all the ice flakes, then even we cannot reduce the temperature by to less than 25 degrees. So next is reducing the temperature of all the aggregate, because that is the major weight contributed to the concrete. So all aggregates we have to cool. This type of work is done when we do concreting of dams. Those might have seen cooling of aggregate is done first. The aggregate is passed through cooling tunnels. The most modern method, which is not yet come to our sites in India, is introducing liquid nitrogen into the mixer, transit mixer at site. Liquid nitrogen is nitrogen which is liquid, its temperature is, I don't remember, minus something, minus 100 and something. It may can be minus 170 or something. Now if we add that into the drum and we rotate drum, the temperature is reduced as much as we want. But that's a very costly process and it's not yet common in India. So what we can do is cooling of aggregate, we can do it. Sprinkle aggregate with, we should have sprinkle on the aggregate stockpiles, and then we cool our mixing drums and add ice flakes. Then for transit mixers also are kept cool by covering it by some type of wraps and so on. This is how we keep the concrete cool. The next method, of which I already told you, avoid hotter part of the day, doing evening, morning or night concrete. So night shift concrete, the 8 hours maximum temperature in day, that you can avoid. So you have 16 more hours to do a concrete work in the day, in the whole 24 hours. So we can call it night concrete, avoid the hot day to avoid temperature, high temperature. Where cracking is important, we have to do that, no option.
Yes, sir. So we will take two, three questions from different categories of, topics. Like there is one, how much quantity of plasticizer can we add at a time of second dosage? You are talking about if at all, I mean, we have to avoid second dosage at site of admixture. But if at all, the requirement is there. So the question is, what is the quantity of plasticizer which can be added at second
dosage? I had already said that this second dose also is to be second dose, which can be provisional. Provisional means if required, is also to be fixed at the time of designing the mix. So when we design the mix, we have one dose of plasticizer plus retarder, whatever is being used, to be added, and a second dose also to be added at the time of taking trials in the concrete mix. So concrete mix we fix and then take trial and see that we get a cube in cubes proper result. So in those trials also, we should have taken the second dose added, because anything we are adding, it's not only increasing the workability of concrete, but we are adding some water. Maybe we are adding some very small amount of air also we are adding, and it is changing the concrete. So this provisional dose we should add into a trial concrete, and we have take trial and we see that we get good result. The only thing is, during the work, this provisional dose, though we have taken in mixed design trials, we may not add. If not required, we will not add. So our strength is not affected. If required, we add it, but strength is proven. So second dose also is to be worked out from the requirement of mixed design. So in mixed design, we have to decide that in certain cases, if we have to increase the plasticity of the concrete, second dose, this much will add. So that amount will be found at the time of mixed design only. So total amount of plasticizer we are adding in two doses, that will be the amount of plasticizer we should control. Now, this depends upon the type of plasticizers we are using. Yesterday only we talked it. Nowadays, PC-based plasticizers are used where high workability is to be added. There, the dosing is important. Second dosing is difficult. But other type of super plasticizers we can add, and second dosing is possible. So with that second dosing, we should take initial trials on.
There is one more question that for the replacement of cement by fly ash, GGBS and microsilica, what is the maximum limit? And it is possible that we use high volume fly ash mix.
Traditionally, we have been using fly ash up to 26% and GGBS up to 35 or 40%. People are not confident of using more than this. The limits, for limits of these, if you put it jointly, means the fly ash and GGBS both, you can see a code on composite cement. There is a code on composite cement. I don't have a reference number yet in my, just in hand. Now that gives you all the limits. Yeah. Now more than that, you can always add, if you have taken trials properly in your mix design. The structural concrete, we can add, go up fly ash up to 50% and GGBS up to 70%. People have done work in Bombay and maybe in Calcutta also. Many of the works can be done where GGBS up to 70% is used in structural concrete, in C structures.
So it's
possible to go up to that value, provided you get your things properly.
Yeah, actually, in Mumbai,
the only problem with more fly ash, 50% fly ash, the problem is in pavements where abrasion resistance becomes a problem. The strength is not a problem. If you get strength, you can do it in water tanks. The advantage in water tanks, which I have told you earlier, is we are limiting the heat of hydration initially, because there are two different actions. One, cement hydrating initially in first 3 days more, and more or less in 7 to 10 days total. And pozzolanic reaction is 21 days onward. So these two reactions are at different time. So heat of hydration is much less, and the temperature gradient problem and cracks due to that are much less. And hence, in water retaining structures, I say it is preferable to use pozzolanic materials or pozzolanic cement, blended pozzolanic cement. We recommend that we must use it. And high volume fly ash is possible and acceptable. There is no problem. The only thing is in design. If you are using high volume fly ash, because fly ash at three levels also, if it is less than 14 or 15% is there, normal way you can do it. 15 to about 30% is there fly ash. You should have a good control on your fly ash supply. Uniformity of fly ash is a very important issue. And more than 30%, this issue of uniformity and mixed design and everything else, and uniformity of material in the total mix, total concrete mix, become more important. So 50% is possible. Yes, sir.
With reference to the sir, you as you said in Mumbai, since we are having such at most of the sites, we are supplying cement. So fly ash up to 35% they are adding in some of the projects, and 40 to 55% is the range of DGBS, and for silica fume it is 8% by weight of total cement. Right. So that is the normal trend which we have reached till now till then. So. We will take some more. Like one question is from Mr. Saurabh Bhandare, that can core cutting test should be allowed in ESR columns and walls in case of doubt in compressive strength, as NDT test gives results within plus minus 25% range. So
see, right. You see, these investigations in case of doubt about the concrete. This happened with our water tanks in Pune and Bombay. We have done it some cases where I was involved. If concrete is in question, the first NDT, very simple, is to do a hammer test that gives you some idea of the problem. Now, the type of problem is, sometimes the concrete apparently good, everything good, somebody has supervised it, and somehow the cube strength result has not come all right. Cube strength result has failed. So on record, you have a doubt. Whereas those who have supervised the work and seen the work, they have no doubt. Now in this type of case, such cases, one has to do something like hammer test and actually judge whether the concrete in situ is proper or not. It's a level of confidence. If we have level of confidence, we have checked the concrete, that by one test it can be all right. If the difference is large, then that is the cube test result is far below, one can find out why the cube test result has gone wrong. Maybe somebody has not put in the cast the cube properly, or curing of the cube there was a problem, or misplace of cube, or a date, or some identity of the cube and something like that. So we should go into that. Okay. If cube test result appears to be reliable, and the hammer test indicates that concrete is average only, not very good and not very bad, we can go about doing other tests. Normally, hammer test by itself is not enough. At least two tests, hammer test plus our sounding, ultrasonic sounding, we should do it. Now, all these non-destructive tests, if indicate that problem persists, the then we can go for the core test. Core test we can take. The problem with core test is it is problem means one has to take out the take the equipment to the site and select a place from which core is to be taken and then take a core. So core is only where, see, if your column has honeycomb in some places, if from the place where you will take core, normally not from a honeycomb place, but somewhere which appears to be a good place, because where appears to be honeycomb, you have to treat it definitely. But you want to know where honeycomb is not there, whether that concrete is good or not. So core is to be taken there. And then core is a representative. So unless you have checked concrete by other tests, core becomes a representative thing. And then core is tested. But core testing is supposed to be most reliable of all other tests. Now the hammer test, the reliability can increase provided you have more results available on that particular type of concrete. That means more or less similar grade of concrete. Say I'm pouring, suppose I'm 30 grade, so 25, 30, 35 of this grade, nearly one above or below. This grade of concrete with similar class of concrete, whether it is pump concrete or normally poured concrete or maybe self-compacting concrete. So class of concrete, as it changes, the correlation curve changes. And also the type of aggregate. The aggregate type, it changes, the correlation will change. So with that, the other things correlate. So whenever others are in doubt, the core has to be taken. And the core results also are then interpreted. Core results are a result of a small cylinder test. A small cylinder test. A standard cylinder test is 150 mm. Cores are normally much smaller than that. And the length of the cylinder is also small. So again, these core test results are interpreted into an equivalent cube strength. Now that again is a conversion, which is again art only. Art or depending upon very much. The conversion factor can be varying from 0.75 to 0.95. So this also is to be taken into consideration. Yes, please.
We'll take one more question. That what is the best method of waterproofing? This is from Engineer Sandeep Pathak. What is the best method of waterproofing for water tank base slab and side RCC walls during construction?
In water tanks, normally we don't recommend any waterproofing. The concrete you have to make waterproof. The concrete has to be waterproof concrete. Waterproof means non-leaky concrete, a small seepage type of wetness type can cross through. This is what we do. So we never provide any waterproofing treatment or a layer to a water tank, maybe city water supply or anything else. If required, now this if is only in certain type of chemicals if you are treating. Even sewage treatment plants, as we construct in India, we are not applying any of the treatment. If I have a alum solution tank being constructed, a alum solution tank has to have a lining, because our reaction of alum with the concrete is so vigorous that my tank normally RCC cannot stand for a week or a month also. So there we have to do a lining, and even a coating thickness is not enough. So I have gone to other extreme to show you when chemicals we are dealing with, we have to do lining. So waterproofing treatment we are not doing, as we are doing to roofs. In buildings, we are applying waterproofing treatment to roof. Now similar treatment you can give it to a slab of a water tank. Nobody can prevent you, and no company will also tell you that you need not do it. But what we want, a good structural concrete, any good engineer will insist on a good structural concrete to be relied upon rather than relying on the leakage being prevented by waterproofing treatment.
Okay. But still, sir, as we see in the practical things, I mean, you have suggested the best way of, you know, constructing, but still there are certain limitations which happens on site, and this, you know, we find that cracks are there or some treatment is required. So as far as we know, there are two, three options available in the market. Number one is the cement-based waterproofing compounds are there. Then polyurethane are there. Epoxy paints are there. So acrylic-based paints are there, and waterproofing, you know, treatments are there. So would you suggest?
Yes. First we have to divide our subject into different parts. Waterproofing treatment is one. Waterproofing lining or coating is another. For waterproofing, something we do in concrete, we add something in concrete, that is one part of it, in the name of waterproofing. That is to improve the pore structure of concrete and to reduce porosity. So mostly plasticizer, what we do, does that work. So this is what we add into the concrete. The cracks do develop, and these cracks in general are to be limited. We have been talking how to limit those cracks, and temperature gradient and so many other things, shrinkage, etc. We reduce shrinkage, compensating compounds we can add to concrete so that it doesn't reduce the shrinkage of the concrete, so chemical reaction remains same, but some expansion is introduced into the concrete such that it is compensated by the shrink. So total final shrinkage is reduced, less. As far as the treatment is concerned, there is a two divide. Those who do buildings and basements, they invariably do waterproofing. And those who do water treatment plants and people like us and pump houses, we have done even up to 10 meter deep pump houses, and we never do waterproofing treatment. We insist on good concrete, and concrete is designed against those leakage. So I have already dealt with all those cases. And if somewhere a leakage is seen, which we are not able to control in spite of doing proper design and proper construction, something definitely goes wrong. Everything is not under control, and somewhere something goes wrong and leakage comes. Then I've already said that we have to grout. Where leakage is very heavy, one of the method is a polyurethane grout. Today is very common, but what we have to understand is polyurethane grout is something like a trump card method to stop a leakage, but it's not permanent. It is a short-term method. It is to be followed by a full repair. A problem comes, and if we are not able to tackle with normal grouting of cementitious mix, in which we can add certain polymeric things also, and some additives and something else. The second grouts are other type of epoxies and other materials which have very low viscosity, less than water also. Those type of grouts are available. And as I said, this polyurethane grout, which forms a foam, and this type of grout can do wonders to stop your leakage. But as I said, that you have to intercept the cracks at some other positions, and you have to do your further grouting and stopping things, stopping your leakages further. So when people are not confident of doing a good quality work, the waterproofing treatment from outside for a basement may be done as a second line of defense. first line of defense is concrete, good concrete, and second line of defense is water proofing lining being given from outside. I'll not recommend. I'll recommend it. I already said that. This type of lining is required in case of tunnels also we are doing. A lot of metros we are doing and tunnels for many other things. Now tunnels are done in sea also for putting rail. Now, and water head is very, very high. I was talking H by T ratio. When H by T ratio is more than 30, 40, something like that, 30, 35, water bar has to be required. Now water bar is something which we put in between the concrete. Now lining or a waterproofing treatment is something which we are putting outside concrete. So it is a water bar. So when the H by T ratio is very, very high, now there are structures where H by T ratio is more than 100, 200, and joints are there. Suppose in the tunnel lining, the precast lining, very good quality material is there, but the lining joints are there. So there some type of the concrete lining also will require some waterproofing from the outs, from the water face, that is inside face of the, inside means on the water face or soil side face of the those concrete units, some waterproofing is to be done.
So we will take two questions more, yeah, and then we'll close the session.
Yes, sir.
And as I told that, I mean, there is a lot of questions, sir, more than 40, 50 questions I can see on board. So I think people can get in touch with Dr. Chen through the email or through phone, and we will be happy to, you know.
You can send me the questions, and then I'll compile all the answers and give it to ACC so that it can be given to all the participants.
Yes, sir. That will be better.
Because I can answer individually, but not collectively to all.
So that will be for sake of everybody. It will be good. So there is one interesting question that by using chlorinated water for concrete, used for concreting, does it increases corrosion in concrete?
Yeah, chlorinated means chloride. If chlorides are high in water, we should never use for concrete or for curing also. There was a building long back in Nagpur, somebody had constructed it. It belonged to a mission hospital. Now somebody didn't notice, they used the water from a well which was available at that site only, and they completed the whole building construction. Within 5 years, things started corrosing, and within 10 years, the situation was such that finally it has to be dismantled. They had spent a lot of money on repairs for 5 years, but it was no use. And it was found that chlorides in the concrete itself was very high. So if chloride in the concrete is high, means our mixing water or curing water should not have chlorides. Our normal water should be used. So sea water should not be used. And if sea water is used, it can be only for plain PCC without any surface reinforcement also. You can construct concrete blocks, means cast blocks of concrete, and they can work, means without putting any reinforcement, if work can be done, this type of work can be allowed. But otherwise, if there are chlorides and limits are given, if you open my those details, how much chlorides we can expect total in concrete, total chloride from all sources together. Now those limits are given. We should be well within those limits. As far as my water tanks are concerned, all our drinking water supply is a chlorinated water supply. And what we find is the walls are saturated with water. It doesn't make much of the problem with walls. But roof, which is not saturated with water, but subjected to water vapor, and the top portion of the water, which is roof, under the roof, the air is saturated with not only water vapor, but the chlorine also, and nascent chlorine. Whenever chlorine is evolved out of water, nascent chlorine, means chlorine as a radical, is evolved, and it has a small life of few seconds only, or maybe a minute, and then it converts into chlorine gas. So this chlorine is highly reactive to our concrete and it attacks the concrete. So normal concrete M30 grade, if it is for 50 years, nothing happened to our water tank, but roof, maybe 20 to 30 years, it corrode. So roof, underside of the roof, we need some additional treatment. So we can apply some type of epoxy or anti-chloride treatment. In my one of the slides, it was written also anti-chloride treatment may be necessary in such cases. But such cases will not work in a sea structure, because through cracks, the water will be able to, the sea water will be able to go inside, and it doesn't work. So we have to have some type of barrier means some lining against those chlorine attacks.
There are a lot of questions, so I will ask again Chandrasekhar to share the email ID of Dr. Jain with everybody on the WhatsApp groups. Maybe somebody have missed.
My ID is also given in the my write-up.
Invitation also we have given, sir. In invitation.
Yeah. So please, you can refer that, because somebody was asking in a question I saw. So just one more question, that for the underground water tanks, all the seismic forces should be taken into account for the design.
Seismic. Oh, yeah. You see, maybe about 20 years back, there was no understanding. And we used to understand that seismic forces means some oscillation. And this affects only structures above ground. But it's not so. Underground structures also are subjected to the seismic excitation. Actually, seismic waves are passing through ground only. So vibrations are there. And underground vibrations are definitely there. And the pressures, the water pressure and soil pressure, and your structure. Now, structure is a rigid structure. You can understand that if I am holding a container and trying to vibrate it, what you know, Hindi mein kahawat hai, adhagal adhajal gagri chalkat jaye. You know, a water tank, when water tank moves, the water will have an impact on the surface of the container tank, in water tank. So this is the impact of the tank, and pressure increases. The rigid tank of a body vibrates along with the ground motion. Whereas water has independent vibration properties. So it doesn't vibrate with the tank. So natural frequency of the two may be different, and pressures are created. Similarly, the soil pressures. So ball should be able to resist these pressure differences, means increase of pressures, and we have to design. So underground structures also are to be designed for seismic activity. Yes, sir. I'm not able to hear.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
Chandrasekhar.
Yes, sir.
Jain sir.
Yeah.
Jain sir, are you there?
Yeah.
There is one or two questions, like, I mean, there are very commonly coming in mind of everybody. So I thought I should take up here only. There is one question that, as you have rightly said, that it is better to use PPC, blended cement. Because particularly in the construction where there is a risk of, or there is a, you know, possibility of cracking, and, you know, everything, durability aspect is more, and we are not able to mix on site. The blending is not proper. Chances are not there at site. So we should use PPC cement. But there is a question, and we also face challenge in the terms that in most of the government departments, they are still, specifying OPC only. Most of the structure.
So yeah, that is the old concept, and many of the government departments. The problem is, I congratulate people, those who have come to this seminar. But out of 20,000 people, 400 maybe are coming to seminar, and rest 99% are out. Now, how to educate everybody? This is a $1 million question. We have come to a stage where fly ash, we are not using it because it is a waste material. We are using fly ash because it's a engineering material which gives us better properties in our concrete, and hence we should use it. The question is at some places, especially a place like Nagpur, where within city from 10 to 15 kilometer we get a fly ash. The fly ash business is handled by people, those who are handling the transportation of sand. They are transporters. So quality of fly ash being brought is a questionable thing. The only thing is, where fly ash is easily and cheaply available, the problem is of fly ash testing. We have to invest enough of money and our efforts. Money is not a big question, but efforts to test fly ash. I'll simply say, each load of fly ash you receive, truck load or a bulker load, a good quality fly ash you cannot receive in truck. If somebody is supplying you in truck, you don't know whether he's supplying you fly ash or a bottom ash. If in a bulker somebody is supplying you, one has to check that a bulker has started from a collection point from a particular precipitator. If I'm constructing my project, I should get bulker from that precipitator only. In a thermal power plant, there are suppose 5 units, and each unit has a particular precipitator. The coal to air ratio may change, the load, they are producing electricity, the total electricity load on being produced may be different, and with that, all these changes, the quality of fly ash changes. So whenever we receive fly ash, we have to check and see that fly ash is uniform quality. Whatever we have assumed in our design, means in our mixed design, in code, if you see the code, there is a specific clause of uniformity of the figures. There are 5-6 qualities. Say, for example, one of the quality is percentage passing through 45 micron sieve. Now this can be easily checked every time you receive a truckload. Before the truck is unloaded or bulker is unloaded, you can check it. So percentage passing, if it changes by 4-5% here and there, it is all right. But in truckload, percentage passing is 5%, and other truckload passing percentage passing is 20%. Then you cannot control the mix properly, the mix which you are giving, the mix which you are giving out. Because what happens is the fine fly ash, which is below 20 micron size, 45 and below, is acting like cement. And those, the heavy particles are acting like sand. So if this percentage changes, the grading of all our, the concrete changes, and then becomes a problem. So control with quality and uniformity of fly ash is what is required to have confidence in use of fly ash with higher percentage. Where it is not possible, one should simply go by the blended cement which a manufacturer is giving and assuring you a uniformity in quality.
Yes, sir. And for the information of the forum, that since last 20 years, PPC cement, which is fly ash based blended cement, it has also evolved. So now the version which is available in the market, which we are producing, it is much, much different from what was produced 10 years before. So this PPC cement is now having durability aspects as Mr.
Yes, I'll add to ACC yes, gives a PPC cement where the strength gain is at par with OPC,
yes,
which was worried by people. So they have their own technology, but technology is by adding super fine powder of limestone. By yes, that, in PPC, when we use fly ash, there is a possibility that a small, very fine powder of the limestone we can add, but that very fine is going beyond 5 micron size. Now, in India, nobody is producing that except some people for their own consumption like ACC. Nobody is supplying you finer limestone. You have to import it from China only today. So there are technologies available like that. And PPC cement, though it is PPC, it gives you all advantage of PCC and with no disadvantage in gaining strength of concrete also. No disadvantage. That's what ACC is offering.
Yes, sir. And that is why it is named as Concrete Plus, or Nami Concrete Plus. Most of you know about it. And if you need any more information about it, you can get in touch with our ACC team. So I think, sir, we have taken a lot of your time. And now it is almost lunch time is also there. So we'd like to close this session for now. Definitely, we will be sharing the, you know, the questions with you. And when we'll receive the answers of this question, we will compile it and we'll share with all the participants who are, who are listening to this seminar. So, thanks a lot, Jensab, and thanks a lot, all the participants. We look forward for the other sessions also from Mr. Jain only. We are planning, you know, in the next coming weeks. Tomorrow we have a session with another expert speaker from Hyderabad. He is from IIIT, head of the Earthquake Engineering Department, Mr. Pradeep Kumar. So our team will be sharing the invitation with you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thanks a lot, Jensab, and everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Sir, over to Chandrasekhar for any closing remarks.
No, sir. Thank you for everyone. The session is very informative, and thanks for everyone. And tomorrow we'll again meet at 11 o'clock in the morning. Thank you, sir.
Thanks.